All right, we are back on Minnesota Sports Live. It is time for another interview, another guest. This guy is referred to as the the Ricky Rubio apologist himself, Cole Munson. It has been too long, my friend. The Wolf season just wrapped up. We're going to be talking a lot about that. But welcome back, Cole. You know, I think you had one vote for best guest of 2020. And, I think that's something to write home about, isn't it?
Yeah, you know what? You know what? In a vote that you can vote for yourself, I'll take one vote. I'll take one vote.
I don't know, but. Yeah. So you admit that it was you're the one who voted for yourself.
Oh, 100%.
Of course he did.
Hey, I got to boost myself up a little bit there. You know when you guys are going to like the grocery store and stuff and you walk by and you see like just all of the apples up there and then there's like one where there's just like one left. No one ever grabs that one. Once you grab that first apple there, people start seeing that and they're like, okay, yeah, that actually looks pretty good. You just got to get it going a little bit. You take that first vote, it increases. I just don't have that type of luck.
Well, here's the thing. You have another opportunity to win the award as well. Best guess of 2021. So this is a big segment for you. This is huge.
This is my Super Bowl. This is my Super Bowl, man.
Yeah, Super Bowl homeboy, as Randy Moss liked to say. But we're going to stick with the Wolves here. But we didn't have you on last week, but we Metz and I, who was filling in for Voldy as well, we were talking about the deal with the Rookie of the Year, and as it turns out, LaMelo Ball wins Rookie of the Year over Anthony Edwards. Cue the booze when this plays live. It will. Cole, I've given my thoughts on this. I want your thoughts since you are our Timberwolves expert, along with Mr. Willertell as well. But we have a lot of experts on the show. But Cole, what are your thoughts on this travesty of LaMelo Ball winning Rookie of the Year? And do you think that Anthony Edwards should have won Rookie of the Year?
So let me start by saying this. I definitely think LaMelo Ball is a great player. I definitely think that he's got a bright future. That being said, this is a travesty. It's just an absolute sham. How do you miss 21 games out of a 72 game season? That's basically that's over a quarter of the season that you missed. And you end up winning Rookie of the Year over a guy that averaged about 20 points a game and over the second half of the second half portion of the season was on fantastic efficiency. And they actually had, I believe, a winning record in the second half of the season when he was playing that well. So you've got a guy that played a full season, contributed to winning towards the end versus a guy that missed over a quarter of the season. And I understand the arguments of that LaMelo's team made the playoffs, but they're in the East. I mean, we could field together a team here just of Minnesota sports players. We'd make the 8 seed in the East. It's not that hard. It's not that hard.
Come apparently.
On. So It all revolves around the injury thing. Like how do you make it? It is very one-sided. If you're going to take away from Joel Embiid for the MVP, if you're going to take away historically different players that have been hurt and then you don't even give them a shot, how do you then go back on that to give LaMelo this award? It just does not make sense in my eyes.
I don't think it makes sense at all. I think, like you said, Cole, it's the name. And I think with LaMelo Ball being so well-known, you know, we get the LeVar thing. We get, you know, Lonzo's in the league. LiAngelo is not good, I should say, to be honest with you. I mean, the guy can barely even make a team, for one. But The fact is that the guy didn't play the amount of games that Ant did. Now, are there aspects of his game that is better than Ant's? Sure. I think he can pass the ball a little bit better. He's more of a bigger playmaker. Ant's more of a I'm going to score type game. But he keeps, you know, he's a 19-year-old kid. Mm-hmm. But let's just say this. He played 21 more games than LaMelo Ball, and he lost. This is a travesty in itself. But I think the good that comes out of all of this, and I think I said this last week too, but it's going to make him stronger and better. And I think for year two as well. So we'll see what happens with that whole thing. But Voldy, obviously you weren't here last week. What are your thoughts? I mean, is this an absolute travesty like we're saying here?
Yeah, I definitely say so. All Ball had to do, LaMelo had to do, was just show up, basically. As soon as he stepped out on the court, the rookie of the year was his. That's basically how everybody put it as this year. And anybody else that, you know, maybe add some decent numbers was not going to win. This was LaMelo's award to lose, unfortunately. And it just so happened that his team so happened to be in a better position overall, even though it's next to impossible if you're, you know, in the Western Conference to end up with a playoff spot and everybody gets a trophy in the Eastern Conference too. I mean, I look at the numbers, you know what, if it just so happens that Edwards doesn't end up with the award, obviously it's already been decided he doesn't get Rookie of the Year. You know what? I add fuel to the fire. 19.3 points per game, 4.7 rebounds per game, almost three assists a game, 41% shooting, 32% from behind the arc, 77% free throw shooter in more games than, you know, basically a third more games than LaMelo played with that wrist injury. And well, they just missed the playoffs as well, did Charlotte, when, you know, LaMelo was out. But I think it's just completely absurd as well. No Minnesota player and or team's ever going to win an award of major significance. And we've learned about that in the other sports here recently, especially with the Minnesota Wild. Even though there is still hope, it's not good, but there's still hope that Kirill the Thrill can bring home the Calder Trophy. But we're holding out hope here. But Anthony Edwards not winning, again, like Munson did bring up, a travesty within itself.
Oh. Real quick, one thing to keep in mind. Do you guys know who votes on this stuff?
You told me it was the writers, right?
It's the media members.
Yeah, exactly.
Media members vote on this stuff. Who's going to be a better story? Anthony Edwards on a historically losing team that doesn't go anywhere? Or one of the Ball brothers that basically were social media, like, absolute stars before?
They had their own show, right?
Yeah, they had their own show. So I find it hard to believe that this isn't partially clickstrip, where it's not somewhat about who's going to sell the most clicks, who's going to drive home the star power and just drive up the brand of the NBA more. And it's sad that that's the case, but I have a hard time believing it's not partial.
Yep. And, you know, the whole notion is that they think, well, Ball's going to be a better player in the future anyway, so we might as well just give him Rookie of the Year. Well, that's not proven. That there's plenty of time before we make that assumption. But if you look at it from this year, Anthony Edwards was the better player, and he was more deserving of the Rookie of the Year. Let me bring up another scenario too. This happened in the NFL. Justin Jefferson, Justin Herbert. Not knocking Justin Herbert, but if you think about what Justin Jefferson did in his season as well, I'd say it's much better than what, I mean, Herbert had. I mean, we didn't make the playoffs. They didn't make the playoffs. It's all about, okay, who's going to give us a better story? Even though Jefferson was like the biggest breakout player in the NFL, he broke Moss's records, everything like that. But again, it's Minnesota getting gypped again. That's how it is. It's just how it is here. That's just, it's frustrating. It's frustrating.
And Herbert's in Los Angeles. There you go. That's all you need. He's got the media. He's got 10 times the media coverage in one city than the Vikings ever will in that sense too. But yeah, you can throw up all the numbers you want. Unfortunately, at the end of the day, with all the awards being voted on by the media, I mean, it's just completely unfair, but you know what? That's just how life goes, I guess.
I'm gonna add another thing too. Who owns the Charlotte Hornets? Michael Jordan, right? Michael Jordan does. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, all respect to MJ. We all love MJ, but still, yeah. I mean, that's just how it is. But you know what? We're going to move on from that and we're going to look into the offseason. So let's talk about that for a second. Okay, Cole, there's a number of things I want to discuss about this, and you have a proposition as well in the offseason, and you think this might work, but we'll get to that in a second. A lot of people have been kind of talking about, you know, the Wolves' odds at, you know, getting the first pick, and right now it's at about 9%, like we were talking about before we recorded. Cole, if you're the Timberwolves, I mean, you're not banking on getting the number one pick. Where do you think the Wolves will pick come lottery time? 3, 4? I mean, what do you got?
Historically, with this curve block, I don't think we're going to have a pick. If you're asking me to be honest, historically speaking, the way that we are, we're not going to have a pick. We're going to lose it this year because we have the worst luck in all of sports. But, I mean, if you're talking, if we get that pick, we are up there in the best of future talent that there is in the NBA.
Yeah.
Especially if we go number one, which a lot of people will complain about because that's 3 number one picks, but I really don't care. They can just disappear. But
yeah.
If you give us Cade Cunningham on this roster with D'Lo, Ants, and Cat, and then throw in Jaden McDaniels, Malik Beasley, Josh Okogie, and some of these guys, that right there is a championship core. Because Cade Cunningham is legit. I'm hearing Cade Cunningham is all parts of Luka Doncic. He's at that level. So if we get the number one pick, 2-3 years down the road, we're looking at a championship season. Again, we're sitting at, what do you say, 9% chance?
9%. 9%. Yeah.
So other guys I'd keep a look at, Evan Mobley, power forward center. I think he'd fit real great next to Cat. He's a defensive just beast. He can knock down a couple jump shots too. He'd fit that Jonathan Isaac role that Orlando has. Just absolutely perfect. And then the kid from Gonzaga, what's his name? I'm bugging on his name right now.
Matt Jalen Suggs.
Yeah, Jalen Suggs.
Minnesota
boy. Bring him in, starting point guard. And then you know, I'll get to what we do when that happens, but bring in Jalen Suggs as our new starting point guard, Minnesota boy.
Wouldn't be against that. Offense.
I'm telling you, those are 3 really good options that we could have come draft time if we end up in those top 3. But odds are against us. Odds are always against us because we're in Minnesota. But you can dream.
That is true. That is true. So we'll have to see. I believe the lottery's tomorrow, right? Is that what we're talking about? Lottery's tomorrow. Yeah. So we will keep our eyes on that and see where it goes. And then we'll kind of get a clearer picture on what they'll do. And obviously if they get a pick, you know, for that instance as well.
Real quick before you move on. I was asking some people today, Matt, in your history of being a Timberwolves fan, is this the most important lottery in Minnesota Timberwolves history?
Is this the more? Well, you know, I almost felt like last year getting that first pick, I feel like was very important, and they got Edwards. We'll see what happens down the road, but I wouldn't go as far to say that yet. I think maybe next year, you know, 2 years from now, but it could be, it very well could be. I wouldn't rule it out, but I wouldn't say so yet. if they, but the thing is, if they get the first pick by some reason, they get Cunningham. Yeah, it's looking pretty good, like you said. So yeah, I'd probably say, it's up there. It's not there, but it's up there. Yeah.
So real quick, here's my case for why I think it is.
Okay.
The drastic swing between keeping your pick and losing your pick in this year's draft is insane, mm-hmm. because the top end talent in this draft is multiple time all-star level players at the top three picks. They're pretty much locked in as borderline all-star plus players. The Evan Mobley, Jalen Suggs, Cade Cunningham, Green coming out of the Ignite team. All these guys are all-star plus players. All of them are going to convert pretty well. So you're talking about a flip between not adding any talent and adding a borderline all-star player coming out of this. And with the core that we have built up, if you add a borderline all-star player to this team, you are looking at a championship core. Versus right now, if there is no changes made, I'm believing we're at about a 6-8 seed level.
And that's basically what you're saying is that they're going to surpass everyone's expectations. A-Rod's going to be looked at to as a fantastic owner. Rosas is going to be just the best GM, you know, to ever come to Minnesota, which, you know, there's still time, but I'd like to think positive on this point, but let's remember it's the Wolves. We passed on Steph Curry, Cole. We've talked about this many times before, but again, we'll see what happens. Let's move on to another topic that a lot of Wolves fans have been bringing up, though. And I think this has to be addressed as well. You know, a lot of people are throwing question marks, you know, if Cat's going to stay. Does he want to be here his whole career? There's been talk that he wants to be a Wolf for life. And then again, Voldy and I kind of looked at each other like, does he really want to be a Wolf for life? I mean, we've seen KG go. So there's that to factor in as well. But let's go with the three that we got here, okay? And then we're going to move on to Cole's proposition. Do we think that Cat, D'Lo, Edwards can lead us into a brighter future here? Do we think that these three guys that we have right now will lead us to where they want to go under the new A-Rod regime, under, you know, Rosas, however this goes? Hell, they might even go to a different city. We don't know. We have no idea. So, Cole, let me ask you this, and then I'll send it over to Voldy. Are those three guys going to be the future of the Wolves here? What do you think?
So let me clarify one thing here quick. Yes, I will never call Payrod the best of anything. Hey, he could bring three championships to this town. I'll never call him the best of anything. He will still be Payrod to me. You know, I will toss all the praise in the world to Mark Lord. I will, yeah. But Payrod is not receiving my praise. As far as this core goes, it all revolves around Anthony Edwards. We've seen what D'Angelo Russell can do. He's going to be a great end of game scorer. He's going to be able to put up 18 to 20 points a game and about 7 assists with pretty rough defense. And Cat is going to be a superstar, but he needs another guy, and D'Angelo Russell's not that guy. So it all hinges with this core on how good Anthony Edwards gets. Now, Dwayne Wade came out earlier in the year saying he's got more talent than I had, and that he could be better than me someday. If that happens, we're looking at multiple chips. But if we've got Dwayne Wade, prime Dwayne Wade on this team, we're looking at multiple chips. But that is a very, like, you're talking capping out at his ceiling. He is arguably the best player that we have drafted in a while based on what I've seen on his rookie year. because he can create, he can shoot, he can score. He's got probably the biggest thing that I've seen from him that I don't see in someone we've drafted in a long time. He's got some dog to him. Like he isn't actually Cat, you know, can kind of disappear in some of the bigger moments. Jimmy Butler comes in, he gets scared off. Andrew Wiggins is soft as tissue paper most of the time. D'Angelo Russell, you know, Nick Young thing, look it up.
Swaggy P.
Good old Swaggy P. But Anthony Edwards, his ceiling is high enough that he can be the best player on a championship team. If Donovan Mitchell is the best player on a one seed, I think he is better than Don. He could very easily be better than Donovan Mitchell.
He could. You're not saying he is.
He is not right now. But I'm saying give him a year or two. Let him get experience. Let him get a little bit of head of steam going. I think he could be the best player on a championship level too.
Because I was about to nominate you for absurd statement.
Oh no,
that's what you're.
No. He is not at that level. He's definitely not.
Not yet.
But he has a very high ceiling. And going back to comparing him to LaMelo Ball, he has a higher ceiling than LaMelo Ball does. It comes back to who do we take in this draft if we get that pick. Because if you add another top-end talent, I'm telling you, this is a championship core, even if Anthony Edwards becomes about 80% of what he can.
Okay. Hold on to this audio, because if you're wrong on this, Cole, you might be up for a absurd statement. I'm just saying. Okay, keep that in mind. Voldy, I send it over to you. Do you think these three, and or if you think that one of them will probably go to another team or whatever, I mean, do you at least one of these three, do you think that they'll lead us into where we want to go in the future?
I think in order for the Timberwolves to get where they need to, I think one of them has to go. I think that's just for one of them to happen, you got to make something happen. You got to get something back, and I hate to say it too, but I think it's got to be D'Lo. I think out of the three, the most expendable out of the lot is D'Lo. I think he's put in some time, but more times than not, either hasn't been healthy or he's just not playing all that much. It's just the combination, and especially towards the late half last year, early point of this year, it was just lack of production and time out on the floor as well. But when fully healthy, you know what? He can be a game changer. But I think for the Timberwolves to get the one or two players in order to make up this full roster, they're going to have to move somebody. And I think D'Lo is the guy that's going to have to be the one to, you know, walk the plank on this one in order for the Timberwolves to get to the other side.
Interesting. Yeah. Because I disagree. I think, and here's what I'm thinking. I think Edwards is definitely, you know, he's going to lead us in the future too. But I almost think it's Cat. And the reason why I think it's Cat is because how many times have we talked about Cat, you know, getting into those big moments and being the guy? Mm-hmm. We haven't seen that. Defensively, he says he's working on. So yes, he has his moments, but when we get off him on that, he tends to get lackadaisical. He tends to not want to play. But this team needs to be built on some defense, because yes, they score a lot of points. They scored a lot of points, but they gave up a lot of points. And there's that. So we have to factor that in as well. And D'Lo, don't get me wrong, I love D'Lo. I think D'Lo is a great shooter. I think, like you said, Voldy, the injuries, that's something we got to factor in too. And I just think for the Wolves right now, they need a guy that can go out and score and stay healthy as well. But they need defensive veterans that know how to play, teach these veteran guys come in, teach these guys how to play defense, because you are not beating these teams that are playing really well in the West. Look at the Suns. Look at how well Book's playing. I mean, the Jazz, even though they lost to the Clippers, I mean, you got to go through that. And then the Lakers are going to come back stronger too. You need to have guys that are willing to go down and play some defense. Okay. And that's what, granted, that's what Jimmy Butler wanted them to do and everything like that, which I don't necessarily disagree with, but you know, that's for another time. I think it's Cat just because of the fact that he might get to a point where he's like, I've done everything. He thinks that he's done everything he could for this franchise. And he's close with everyone in the franchise too. And, you know, we wish him the best and everything like that. But I think he wants to be on a team where he doesn't have to be the guy. So I almost feel like it could come down to that. I could see D'Lo leaving and whatnot, but we'll see what happens. I'm probably going with Cat here on this one. So I'll play devil's advocate. But Munson, what is your proposition? Speaking of D'Lo, you have a proposition to make not only to myself and Boldy, but the Zoners as well. Please hit us with it.
So my proposition, now this is not going to look as great coming off the playoff series you just came out of.
Already.
Basically, the proposition is we flip D'Angelo Russell for Ben Simmons. One-for-one trade, they're making about the same salaries. Ben Simmons comes in day one. He is probably a top-five defender in the league. He can lock down pretty much 1 through 4. I don't know if he could guard a center very well, but he could lock down 1 for 4. He was taking out Trae Young for a lot of that series. And doing a heck of a job on him. So he comes in, he is your glue guy, he is your main defender, he is your Draymond Green to the Steph Curry and Klay Thompson. And you send out D'Angelo Russell, who you guys love D'Angelo Russell. I think he's all right as a third option. He does not play defense, and I don't know if you can win with the amount of lack of defense that we have. So you would send out D'Angelo Russell, you would receive Ben Simmons, you'd get a large dose of defense coming in, and we have the shooting to surround with him. You've got, because your starting lineup at that point will be Ben Simmons, Malik Beasley, Anthony Edwards, Katz, and Jaden McDaniels. You've got 4 pretty good to excellent three-point shooters surrounding Ben Simmons, with Ben Simmons being able to focus on creating offense and playing lockdown defense on their best player.
Okay. Well, so when you brought this up, we've actually talked about this before. You brought up a lot of propositions with Ben Simmons. Mm-hmm. You have an infatuation with Ben Simmons. I don't know what it is. I don't know why it is, but let me bring this up. Ben Simmons has had plenty of opportunities. Yes, he's a good defender, and yes, he would fit in well. But the question is, can you rely on losing a shooter like D'Lo? Now, D'Lo is a great shooter, nonetheless. I think he's fantastic when he's on. Like you said, doesn't play very good defense. That's what the Wolves need. Like I said before, they need defense. Now, here's another issue that we have to bring up with this is that Ben Simmons, although he is very good defensively, offensively, he was terrible. This last playoff series, he was terrible offensively. I'm looking at some of the stats against the Hawks here. 5 points. On June 20th, 6 points before that, 8. I mean, he couldn't hit the broadside of a barn. But the Wolves, here's the thing. The Wolves need both shooting and defense, too. They need a guy that can score and consistently. Malik Beasley can score. Mm-hmm. But is Malik Beasley going to cooperate and stay out of trouble? That's another thing we got to consider too. So I guess I'm not sold on Simmons as everyone else is, but I just wanted, I, if they do make the trade, they got to figure out some of his off, because I mean, in the off season, Philadelphia is like putting him through the ringer to be able to or score points. I mean, the guy can't shoot a three to save his life. That's for one. But then again, he's had some injury issues, but a lot of teams think that he can fix them. Can the Wolves fix them? Well, it's the Wolves. So you just gotta take a chance and see where it goes. I wouldn't be necessarily against it, but I would just say you lose a shooter, you add a defender, then you got to add another guy as a shooter at some point if they do make that trade. What do you think? What do you got, Cole?
Okay.
You're shaking your head.
What was that?
You're shaking your head. Oh. Go ahead.
Well, okay, so here's the thing. Like, you say that we're losing a shooter, gaining a defender, but outside of Okogie and Culver, which we can swap those two guys out for pretty much anything, we've got a solid group of shooters right there. We've got, like I said, the four people probably starting around him all can shoot.
Yeah.
Depending on who we get in the draft, Jalen Suggs can shoot. Cade Cunningham can hit a shot. Guys coming out the bench, Hernan Gomez can hit threes. Jalen Noel can hit threes. Naz Reid is a pretty good three-point shooter. I'm not touching Ricky Rubio. We're not going down that road.
Don't you dare. But, don't you dare. I'm in a good mood today. Don't you dare.
But here's the thing, is you've got enough shooters and enough scorers on this team. Right now, the only top-notch outside defender that we have is Josh Okogie. And if you want to talk about bad on offense, Josh Okogie is 10 times worse on offense than Ben Simmons is.
Three-point shooting's bad, too, with him. Yeah, I agree.
At least Ben Simmons knows he can't hit a jump shot. Josh Okogie doesn't know that he can't shoot, and he'll still go 1-for-6 in a night and absolutely kill you every single time. So this brings you in a top flight defender for when you go against the Kevin Durant's, when you go against LeBron James, when you go against the Giannis's, when you go against the Devin Booker's, people like that. This gives you that top flight defender that we currently do not have. I love Jaden McDaniels. Jaden McDaniels is not that guy. He's just not that guy. So you need to bring in a top-of-the-line defender that is also a top-of-the-line creator, and when he's not a bit messed up in the head, is a top-of-the-line finisher. He cannot hit a jump shot, but that is one flaw in an otherwise pretty much perfect game.
All right. Voldy, what do you think of Cole's proposition?
I want it. I want it to happen. I just think in this day and age, everybody can shoot the basketball. It takes a very select group to be able to defend when, especially you're seeing games finishing out 115 to 110 or, you know, 135 to 120. I mean, you got to have guys out there to play some defense a little bit.
And yeah,
Simmons, better overall player than for sure D'Lo. And that's putting it very lightly in just looking at it from a very far, far view. I think Ben Simmons would definitely be, and especially the way things have kind of been the last couple of years, you know, the whole trust the process has kind of run its course out in Philly a little bit. And I think now is the time that the process is starting to get a little bit of fracture in it as well. So this may be the first piece, and hopefully it's a good piece as well. I am all for Ben Simmons in that proposition, especially if it's going to be a straight 1-for-1. May take a little bit more sweetening of the deal for Philly to take a view like this, I think.
So, you know, Voldy, I don't necessarily with you guys thinking the way that if Ben Simmons would come to Minnesota, would I be against it? No, I wouldn't be against it. The only thing that I think that this could hamper their shooting ability, yes. But if they're able to add someone after that whole aspect, then we'll see what happens. But let's think about it for a second, okay? You add Simmons. You go out and you get, you know, Rosas is going to have to work some of his magic now. Let's just say that happens. Will this hurt the Wolves? Maybe. Well, but will it more help them? who knows? I guess we'll have to figure out how that will all transpire. But if it happens, hey, it's fine with me. We'll see what we can get. And like you said, I think this is a big year for D'Lo to prove, hey, look, I want to be here, and I want to play well, things like that. I want to, stay healthy and whatnot. But then again, like you mentioned, the Swaggy P deal, you never know what you're getting with that. Right, Cole?
Never know what you're getting. It's one phone call away, one live stream away.
Oh, goodness.
Oh, good Lord. But anyway, we'll see what happens. But Cole, we appreciate you coming on. It's been too long since we talked Wolves, and you've made a good case for best guess of 2021. We might have you on again. We probably will before the year's out. But if that Ben Simmons trade happens, I know the first person who I'm going to talk to. Okay, mm-hmm. We'll have to see how it goes.
I better get some credit for calling that too. I'm the one that put it out there, baby. Let's go.
We'll give you
out there a year in advance.
We'll give you credit where credit's due. All right. We'll give you where credit is due. So we'll go from there. But Cole, thanks for coming on again. And thank you for not going into the Ricky Rubio ordeal with me, because I think that's another conversation that we'll have down the road. Mm-hmm. So we'll see what happens with that. But coming up next is one of our special segments. So let's get it going with some of, I think, maybe Voldy's virtues. We'll see.